No pleasure pleasures me as doth a well-spun tale, be it sad or merry, shallow or deep. If the subject's privy business or unpleasant, who cares a fig? The road to heaven's beset with thistles, and methinks there's many a cowpat on it. As for length, fie, fie. A bad tale's long, though it want but an eye blink for the telling, and a good tale short, though it take from St. Swithin's to Michaelmas to have done with it. Ha! And the plot is tangled, do ye say? Is it more knotful or bewildered than the skein o' life, that a good tale tangles the better to unsnarl? Nay, out with your story now, and yours as well, sir, and shame on the both of ye, thou art not commenced already. Spin and tangle till the dog star sets in the bay. A tale well wrought is the gossip of the gods that see the heart and point of life on earth, the web of the world, the warp and the woof. Christ, I do love a story, sirs. Hey everybody, thank you for watching Leaf by Leaf. Today, I get to talk about John Barth's The Sot-Weed Factor, his third novel from 1960. This is in the Anchor Paperback reissue that also features a foreword by John Barth. I'm so excited to finally talk about Barth here on the channel. I love John Barth. In fact, I first discovered him through his story collection, Lost in the Funhouse. I had just finished grad school, and I was hungry for just more lectures, more classroom treatments. And so I discovered the Yale Open Courses and found that Amy Hungerford had a lecture series, a whole course on the American novel after 1945. And one of the books was John Barth's Lost in the Funhouse. Go and listen to the lecture. The book is just such a treat. I knew immediately after the first few stories, really upon opening the book and seeing that he had created one page that you cut out and you form a ribbon into a Mobius strip, and it makes an infinitely looped tale. I knew that this was an author for me, and I have to be honest, some of the appeal also has to do with place, which is very important to John Barth, and that place would be Maryland. In fact, The Sot-Weed Factor is set in and based on the colony or the province of Maryland and all the feuds between Catholics and Protestants, the Catholics represented by King James and the Jacobians, the Lord Baltimore, the Calvert family, and then also the Protestants and William and Mary and Governor Nicholson. But for me, I was born the only Virginian to a family of Marylanders, and my family is all from around the Washington, D.C. area, Rockville, Bethesda, Wheaton, Silver Spring, and since they moved to Virginia and had me, the entire rest of the family was still in Maryland. And so my childhood consisted of many, many, many trips up to Maryland. And it became a very special place to me, especially both sets of my grandparents were there. We spent all major holidays there. And so Maryland became this place that I sort of longed for. I haven't really thought too much about that. You know, who knows what all was really going on in my mind or my subconscious as a kid, but it just became this place where it seemed like a sort of fantasia to me, this fantastic land that we traveled to by car. And in those days, you know, I didn't have anything like a tablet or phone, iPad, anything like that, but I did have books. And my mom would always buy me these road trip books that had all these different neat crafts and things you could do. But she would also talk to me about facts about Maryland. I loved to check out books about Maryland. I loved all the facts, the state flower, the state tree, the state bird, the state crustacean, which is of course the blue crab. So there is a part of me that with John Barth and the fact that he's from East Cambridge on the eastern shore of Maryland, he's through and through a Marylander, taught for a long time at Johns Hopkins in Baltimore. There's something special there with place that I connect with. But to be sure, The Sot-Weed Factor is not so much about Maryland as it is about America. I highly recommend Barth's Friday book, The Friday Book. This is a collection of lectures and essays and pieces he wrote for the New York Times Book Review. And it really gives an overview of what an amazing genius John Barth really is. He's this sort of cool everyman. I mean, he was a jazz drummer and supported himself through college, gigging as a drummer. He went to New York to study music and to be a jazz great, and quickly learned that that just wasn't for him. And he ended up finding his way to literature. So I'm also a drummer. You know, there are all these affinities that I could go on and on about, but let's get more into material and less in my own head. The Friday Book, after typical Barthian play and fun with titles and subtitles and epigraphs, he has a piece that was in the New York Times Book Review in 1982, and he titled it, "Some Reasons Why I Tell the Stories I Tell the Way I Tell Them Rather Than Some Other Sort of Story Some Other Way." And this is just, like I say, classic Barthian. He's very keen, very playful. You can tell he loves to tell stories. He loves to tell jokes, and it comes out through and through in his fiction. In this essay, we find out that he is a twin with his sister Jill, hence they were named Jack and Jill. He's from what he calls scrappy East Cambridge, a crab and oyster town on the eastern shore of Maryland. He says, "I am the least psychological of storytellers, yet even to me it is apparent that I write these words and all the others in part because I no longer have my twin to be wordless with." As it happens, the significance and symbolism of twins will be one of the crucial plot points. As he presses on in his observation of himself and why he writes the way he does, he says, "Your web-foot amphibious marsh-nurtured writer," meaning, you know, he's talking again about where he's from there on the eastern shore, "that writer will likely by mere reflex regard any conventional boundaries and distinctions as arbitrary, fluid, negotiable, form versus content, realism versus irrealism, fact versus fiction, life versus art. His favorite mark," meaning this type of writer, "his favorite mark of punctuation will be the semicolon." As a writer, he refers to himself as an arranger. And this comes from his time spent studying music and jazz. His chiefest literary pleasure is to take a received melody, an old narrative poem, a classical myth, a shop-worn literary convention, a shard of my experience, a New York Times Book Review series, and of course he's playfully referring to the medium for which he's writing. And he says, "and improvising like a jazz man within its constraints, reorchestrating it to a present purpose." And we'll see this especially in the Sot-Weed Factor. As he talks about the way that he grew up and his education and then his foray into studying jazz and then eventually landing at Johns Hopkins to study literature, he tells us basically that he had to start from scratch and he sort of had to play catch up in college. He said that when he first started taking classes there, everybody was talking about the French Revolution and the Renaissance and all these things, and he had no clue really what they were talking about. It was good that he fell in with incredible professors, and he said that it was their way, and I approve of it, not to talk to us through Homer and Dante and Cervantes and Proust and Joyce, but to talk through us to those great ones, with whom they, the professors, were at home. He found himself employed as a book filer in the stacks of the classics department and the William Foxwell Albright's Oriental Seminary. And this is where he fell in love with the Book of the Thousand Nights and One that also contain Sir Burton's annotations and Rabelais and the Sanskrit ocean of story, these tales within tales told for the sake of their mere marvelousness, as he says. And you'll see this in the Sot-Weed Factor, because it's in that tradition that extends from Chaucer to Boccaccio, or I should rather say Boccaccio to Chaucer, all the way through Rabelais, and then even Jonathan Swift and Alexander Pope, because in the end, the Sot-Weed Factor is a satire. And it's based on a historically true document, a poem that was written that called itself a satire by Ebenezer Cook. Satire is, of course, a very barbed genre in which to write. It has been long misunderstood and continues to be misunderstood. In many respects, people will conflate the very objects of the author's satire as something that they condone or that they approve of, when in fact, they're maximizing the stigma. They're maximizing the, what should we say, the lens through which we look at certain actions and certain terrible portions of our history. Nonetheless, Barth does a great job modulating between historical verisimilitude, searing satire, and then a sort of retrospective commentary. The two chief characters in this book are Ebenezer Cook. He's our everyman, and he has a vocation. He has found that he is a poet and that he's very good at writing, but he doesn't really have any content. He doesn't know what to write about. He doesn't know what his object or subject really is. So he's looking for meaning and purpose in his vocation. As it happens, his father, Andrew Cook, who has a tobacco plantation in Malden in the province of Maryland, has Ebenezer travel to Maryland to take over as his factor or his trading agent. And so one of the meanings of the title, the Sot-Weed Factor, is the tobacco trading agent. Sot-Weed being a colonial English slang term for tobacco. So that's the practical purpose of this westward odyssey in which Ebenezer Cook and many other characters engage. But the meaning and purpose he finds for his vocation as a poet is to write the very first Marylandiad, just as we call the Iliad, the song, the poem on Ilium or Troy. This will be the first epic poem of the colonial New World and of Maryland province specifically. Henry Burlingame, school teacher that Andrew employed for his two twin children, Anna and Ebenezer. This relationship between Ebenezer and his schoolmaster, Henry Burlingame, and Game is in there in his name very deliberately. He is a trickster, he is a nihilist, he is an imposter, he is a gamester. And he is seeking to uncover more about his father's identity, stemming out of the colonial mid-Atlantic area, so that he can understand his own identity. He has discovered a sort of hidden or secret document that went along with John Smith's journal about the Virginia Company, the Virginia colony, that sheds a completely different light on everything that was going on and gives us another interesting look at the Pocahontas story from the mind of John Barth. But these two help to make this book in part one of those great friendship or cohort tales in the manner of Don Quixote and Sancho Panza, Prince Hal and Falstaff, and here Ebenezer Cook and Henry Burlingame. Like I said, one meaning of the title is the direct translation that Barth was going for, which is basically the tobacco trade agent. Ebenezer Cook is in fact the person behind that title. He is to be that tobacco trade agent, that Sot-Weed Factor. And it's also the title of the historically true document that Barth came across, written by Ebenezer Cook, and declared itself a satire. And so it also appears in this book. In fact, Barth has said that what this novel is sort of a novel playing at being a novel, written by an author playing at being an author. And it's written in the third person. It stays very closely with Ebenezer Cook. But at the very end, we get a chapter called The Author Apologizes. And Ebenezer Cook gives his epitaph. Like I said, this is written in the grand tradition of the ribald body storytelling of Rabelais. It's overflowing with stories and just playfulness and a celebration. It's in praise of, perhaps, human folly. But Barth said in the foreword to the book that he realized as he was writing it that he wasn't actually writing about nihilism. he was writing about innocence, or specifically the loss of innocence. This was actually going to be the third in a trilogy of his realist novels, which began with The Floating Opera and then The End of the World, but it quickly kind of became its own project. He steeped himself in much, much research of the time, and he brings in a vernacular the same way that Pynchon will use a vernacular for his Mason and Dixon, and the way that Volman uses a vernacular for his Argal. There will be some connection to those two books, even though Barth's book came out in 1960, whereas Mason and Dixon came out later and Argal came out later. But, you know, there's going to be overlap with the Pocahontas tale, with William Penn of Pennsylvania and the Calverts of Maryland, and the border dispute that ultimately led to Mason and Dixon going and charting that eponymous line. And then also with the Jesuit relations, we have some Jesuits in here, and they refer to their relation that they have to write about the Maryland province and send back to home base, as it were. He steeps himself in the political situation of the late 17th century, again, between Protestants and Catholics, between King William and King James and the Jacobians. He gets into the history of the sort of settling of Maryland and the moving around of its capital. We see the establishment of what will become Annapolis, the capital of Maryland. But besides just a great researcher and someone who is adept at puns and jokes, and someone with an ear for diction and a way of capturing that and modulating it between characters, Barth is simply a great writer and a joy to read. This is the first paragraph. In the last years of the 17th century, there was to be found among the fops and fools of the London coffee houses one rangy, gangling flitch called Ebenezer Cook, more ambitious than talented, and yet more talented than prudent, who, like his friends in folly, all of whom were supposed to be educating at Oxford or Cambridge, had found the sound of Mother English more fun to game with than her sense to labor over, and so rather than applying himself to the pains of scholarship, had learned the knack of versifying, and ground out choirs of couplets after the fashion of the day, a froth with Joves and Jupiters, a clang with jarring rhymes, and string taut with similes stretched to the snapping point. I hope you can hear all that consonance with the letter F, the S sounds. I guess that would be called sibilance. We get these novel words that are rooted in the Old English and Middle English, and that would be most likely used at that time, like flitch, which is a slender cut or a piece of something, or a cured, salted and cured side of bacon. We've got choir, which is a set of 24 and sometimes 25 sheets of paper. Hence, he ground out choirs of couplets. But listen again to the sibilance with all the S's and the C's. In the last years of the 17th century, there was to be found, and then it switches over to those F's. And it says, found among the fops and fools of London coffee houses. And those F's set up for that first standout word, that gangling flitch called Ebenezer Cook. And this is the very first description we get of our everyman hero, our everyman protagonist, a rangy gangling flitch. And how great is that description of the type of poetry that this rangy gangling flitch puts out? A froth with Joves and Jupiters, a clang with jarring rhymes, and string taut with similes stretched to the snapping point. This is just good, fun reading. You're in the hands of someone who loves the English language, that loves the sound of it as much as Ebenezer Cook himself, someone who has command of the time in which they're writing, the diction in which they're writing, but also has a very playful side. Ebenezer is well-educated, Henry Burlingame. It seems to be steeped in all knowledge of the world, and especially in the great debates, intellectual debates of the day, not only political, but also metaphysical. You've got the materialists versus the idealists. All this comes into play. But we get a glimpse at Anna and Ebenezer and their education. It says both were great readers and loved the same books. Among the classics, the Odyssey and the Metamorphoses, the Book of Martyrs and the Lives of the Saints. They loved to play word games. Of these, they had a great variety, ranging from the simple, how many words do you know beginning with S? Or how many words rhyme with faster? To the elaborate codes, reverse pronunciations, and homemade languages of their later childhood. It sounds like Barth could honestly be talking about the way that he and his sister Jill were raised. I don't know for a fact, but it sounds like something that Barth would be into. Since this book is also a love letter to the English language, we get the historically important Norman conquest as part of Anna and Ebenezer's education. And Barth being the teacher, the natural pedagogue that he is, we get such pronouncements as there is no perfect educational method. And there will be many different musings on pedagogy and history and politics, language, poetry. That intellectual setting of time and place, it comes out in lists of the philosophers of his era: Bacon, Hobbes, Descartes, Spinoza, Leibniz, Locke. He learned little. Of its scientists, Kepler, Galileo, Newton, less. Of its theologians, Lord Herbert, Cudworth, Moore, Smith, Glanville, nothing. But Paradise Lost, he knew inside out. The Hudibras, upside down. And that is Samuel Butler's seminal poem, The Hudibras. And it's written in a jangling pattern that they get into and that Ebenezer will model his own writing after. But this goes to show that, you know, he learned a little of the philosophers, a little less of the scientists, and nothing of the theologians. So Ebenezer Cook, he is a true poet and a lover of literature. And so is John Barth, although one gets the sense that he knows a lot of the philosophers and more of the scientists and theologians than Ebenezer Cook. But one of the things that comes out in here is that love for reading. In a sense, Barth is teaching us to read. Here's the teacher, Burlingame. You must attend to the how of it, Burlingame said, else thou art as much a Boeotian as he that reads the Iliad no farther than the invocation, where the end of it all is plainly told. So in other words, it's the how over the what. So obviously anybody can go and just read a synopsis of a book or, you know, go and find the main idea, what it's about. A deep and close and serious reader wants to understand how that became the what, and also the way in which that was delivered when, like the Sot-Weed factor, craft comes into play very much so. For example, listen again to these L's and M's. Lockets, cried Ebenezer to his cabman, and sprang into the hackney with a loose flail of limbs like a mismanaged marionette. So we have not only the beauty and the flow of these words, but the humor. Let's listen now just for what he's actually saying and the way he's saying it. Basically, two lockets, he's telling the cabman to go to a place. Lockets, cried Ebenezer to his cabman, and sprang into the hackney with a loose flail of limbs like a mismanaged marionette. At one point, Burlingame and Ebenezer are in the midst of a discussion, and Burlingame is giving him case after case after case, sort of in that fashion of a philosophical argument when you're trying to make a case about something. And Burlingame is getting ready to state another case. He says, now another case, and then it has an M dash, and Ebenezer cuts him off and says, keep thy case, I beg you, Ebenezer said. I am cased from head to toe. Now, as far as the plot, there is a very, very clear plot here, although the complexity of it comes from the complexities of all the different tales piling up on top of each other. Like I said, this is a westward odyssey for Ebenezer Cook, but we see characters show up and disappear and come back in different disguises. Burlingame himself changes identities more than Pynchon's Slothrop. There are chases and foils and capers aplenty. Wrapped up in all this is also a complex consideration of all of the human folly that goes into it. Everything from rape to adultery to slavery, you name it, it's in here. Again, it all goes back to the loss of innocence. This is also a Künstlerroman. So a Bildungsroman is, of course, a coming-of-age tale. A Künstlerroman is the word for a novel about an artist's coming into being. And that's what's going on here for both Barth and Ebenezer Cook. And Barth talks about how what happens in this book is that Ebenezer Cook comes to become the writer he had innocently presumed himself to be. And Barth says that it was the exact same for him while writing this. Ebenezer declares that he would versify his voyage to Maryland from beginning to end, as he had planned before. But so far from writing a panegyric, he would scourge the province with the lash of Hudibrastic, as a harlot is scourged at the public post, catalog her every wickedness, and expose her every trap laid for the trusting, the unwary, the innocent. And he declares triumphantly, he says, I shall make the piece a fiction. And this is the moment when he realizes he's not going to write the Marylandiad. He's not writing this encomium, or as he says, this panegyric to the province. He has been through enough at this point, roughly halfway through the book, where he says, you know what? I'm just going to catalog all of its folly, and I'm going to make the piece of fiction, or again, a satire. Why does this happen? Well, because he's gone through what is called the ceremony of innocence, his rite of passage, where his ideals are sort of torn by reality. And so halfway through the book, for Ebenezer, just as with Barth himself, the project, the Künstlerroman, the output of his life shifts. The heat of his sustained creative passion must have either enlarged his talent or softened his critical acumen, for never before had he felt so potent, assured, and poetic as in the composition of this satire. What business hath a poet with the business of the world, he asked himself rhetorically, with properties and estates, the tangled quarrels of governments, and with nets of love? They are his subject matter only, and the more he plays a part therein, the less he sees them clearly and entire. And that is the rub for many writers, is being a part of this world, but also having to stand back and put it at arm's length and observe it, or rather experiencing it from within, observing it from without to write about it. It's harder than one thinks, all the more amazing when someone pulls off something like what John Barth has done with the Sot-Weed Factor, and also sets himself at centuries worth of arm's length from the time in which he's writing about. It's truly a masterpiece of imaginative literature. At one point, Ebenezer, talking to his assistant, I can't remember what he's referred to as, but Bertrand, and I think they've switched roles at this point, but this conversation about Plato and his proposition of the Republic, which, of course, notoriously kicks poets out of the society and wants a philosopher king. Well, Ebenezer says that in his town, philosophers will all be welcome, so long as they do not start insurrections, but a poet shall be their god, and a poet their king, and poets all their counselors. 'Twill be a poetocracy. The poet king, Bertrand, 'tis a thought to conjure with. Nor is it folly, I swear. Who better reads the hearts of men, philosopher or poet? Which is in closer harmony with the world? But Ebenezer's poetic idealism is always in tension with Burlingame's nihilism. Burlingame says, here we sit upon a blind rock, hurtling through a vacuum, racing to the grave. 'Tis our fate to search, Eben. And do we seek our soul, what we find is a piece of that same black cosmos, whence we sprang and through which we fall, the infinite wind of space. Mary, laughed Henry, if you saw it clear enough, 'twould not dizzy you, 'twould drive you mad. Two things alone can save a man from madness. Dull-headedness is one, and far the commoner. The book is overflowing not only with stories and tales and anecdotes and punchlines, but also with aphorisms. There are more aphorisms in here than what Sancho Panza spurts out in Don Quixote Part 2. And they range in tone from the ribald and bawdy and off-color all the way to the profound, such as, when a fox hath a hen within his grasp, he will eat her. And when a man hath a woman in his power, he will swive her. Whom fortune buffets, the whole world beats. When all's consumed, repentance comes too late. Anger begins with folly and ends with repentance. Anger glances into wise men's breasts, but rests only in the bosom of fools. A man may love his house and yet not ride on the ridgepole. The older the millstones, the finer the grind. One of these tales that I particularly loved comes very close to the end, and it's the tale of the invulnerable castle. Where many exits are many entrances. But where one entrance is, there is no exit. I always talk about rereading, and here is another assertion for the importance of rereading. Do you recall when we read Euripides with Henry, how we contemned the Trojan women out of hand? And he says, but I tell you, Anna, I contemn the woman, he's talking about Hecuba, I contemn the woman no more. And what he's talking about here is that they pronounced a judgment upon these characters and their actions when they first read them. But now, way later in life, and with all this new experience, they see the book as if a totally different text. And so just as I thoroughly, thoroughly enjoyed rereading The Sot-Weed Factor, I hope that those of you who have read it are inspired to read it again, and anyone who hasn't read it will pick it up. If you like big books, if you like the, you know, encyclopedic and maximalist fiction, although I will say Barth is known as a black humorist, The Literature of Exhaustion, which is the title of one of his pieces in the Friday book, and it's basically the literature that exhausts all of its possibilities. This could definitely be considered a satiric historical novel within that category of the literature of exhaustion, but you have to be careful because Barth is nothing like Pynchon and nothing like Gass. He isn't like Hawks. You're not going to fall into complicated, complex, and obscure problems with just the narrative itself. Barth invites into the text and leads the reader. Barth is writing to entertain you, to pull you in, to enjoy his literature. He's not obscuring anything in this book. It reads like a conventional narrative. So it doesn't have the hijinks, I guess is what I'm saying, that we typically ascribe to postmodernists and encyclopedists and so on. But The Sot-Weed Factor is no less an amazing achievement and one of the highlights of American literature. Thank you. Thank you so much, John Barth.